I'm Arthur Boyle of Performance Appraisal Services. We're residential real estate appraisers with a company founded in 1994 by Mike Gianelli and I in the basement of my house in Malden. We've since grown to have offices in Malden and Pembroke. We serve the eastern Mass counties, including Cape Cod. A good client for us is an attorney or a private landowner or a private property owner who's going through a probate process or a divorce division of property. Call us at 781-293-6900. Ask for Arthur Boyle or Amanda Boyle Grazioso. Our first name is Performance.
Today is January 23rd. It is 6:34 p.m. Donna Bagni, Gary Fine are present. Gail McSweeney is out due to health reasons, wishing her the very best. We have signed payroll. I would like to please make a note that this meeting is being available to the public through an audio recording, which will be used to ensure accurate record of the proceedings produced in the minutes of the meeting. All comments made in open session will be recorded. We do have PAC TV here. Can you just state your name for the record?
Ryan.
Ryan?
Yeah.
And then I believe Pembroke News is here, but yes. I don't believe that camera's on as of yet.
No, but I just stepped out for a minute.
Okay. In our package, we do have the minutes of the meeting dated January 9th, 2017, along with all the attached appropriate paperwork. I believe there is one piece missing, which was the section in regards to what was referred to in our last meeting about a document from Copel and Page. So I'm still waiting to add that to the information package for the June 9th meeting, but with that being not here at the moment, I'd like to make a motion to accept the minutes of January 9th, 2017 as written and presented.
I'll second that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, perfect. Next thing I'd like to go on to is that from that last meeting that we held, there was a question that came up in regards to a communication. I'm actually going to leave this until we get down to the item that has to do with the health agent's job description, but I did send out an email for clarification from legal counsel, so I would like to submit this and read it in open meeting and have it attached to our minutes. The only other correspondence that the Board of Health has received is I've received a letter from GEC, which is Goldman Environmental Consultants. They're located out of Braintree, Mass., in regards to the property located at 158 Center Street. I have discussed this with the health agent. There is a plume that is being monitored at this point. It's where the old tumbleweed was.
The gas station, they believe, is not verified at this point, but the origin of plume would have been the very old gas station that predated the CVS on the town common lot, the center plaza there, would have migrated under the street and over to the building that was the old tumbleweeds building. I believe it's now a law firm, and affected some of the property over there. It is significant enough that it ought to be monitored. It does not present an imminent public health threat. It will require some attention if the property is to be further developed, which of course was the plans when the property was sold. So at this point, this environmental firm is doing what they are required to by notifying the town that they are aware of its existence.
Okay. And you are on top of that and will be monitoring it?
That. Really, until someone disturbs it, there's no way to compel the property owners to immediately do something about it, and it doesn't present an immediate public health risk. But I'm sure it might affect the current property owners' ideas or designs or how they might develop it or not develop it. So at this point, it's a wait and see what is proposed that would include an environmental remediation program appropriate to the development that would take place.
Okay.
Point of clarification, is that property being considered for development or being...
Correct. So the quote-unquote rumor, and I have yet to verify with the town treasurer collector or anyone else that would have seen the deed change hands, but my understanding is that property has been purchased by Cumberland Farms Corporation with the intention of moving Cumberland Farms across the street and developing that into one of the more traditional Cumberland Farms like you might see down in Plymouth, the large plaza style. Whether or not they're going to move forward with that, given this news, or if this just changes their time scope or program, I can't say. They're not required to tell us until they decide to pull a permit to do some sort of action.
So is that the site where the law office is located and behind?
Correct.
Okay, nothing to do with the gas station that's beside?
It has nothing to do with the current gas station in existence. Based on the shape and the location of the plume, I'm inclined to agree with this engineering firm. The likely source of it was the much older gas station that used to be sitting on the corner of Mattakeesett and Center, where the CVS sits currently.
Mm-hmm. So in terms of monitoring it, what does that involve from your point of view?
They would do more borings and monitor the movement of the plume, see how large or small it is. Right now it's, you know, a concern, but it's not a hugely significant plume. And as I said, it doesn't present an imminent public health risk based on the data they have there. It's very similar to the plume that existed, if some people remember, by the town forest from the old gas station that used to be across the street from there. It's something you monitor and pay attention to. You obviously wouldn't want to, you know, drill a drinking well or an irrigation well into that. That would be a poor idea. But right now, it's not something that's going to come out of the earth and hurt someone. Obviously, the concern is if the property is developed and you do dig up this earth, you're going to have mm-hmm. to, you know, do something with those soils. Those soils would be considered contaminated and would have to be dealt with appropriately.
So the status that we're at now is...
Well, status quo right now today, until someone comes forward with a plan to do something different.
Okay. And you just got this letter today, Chairman Bagni?
It
came in a couple days ago.
It was left in my folder.
Okay.
Under the, yeah. So I actually just opened it this evening and spoke to Lisa about it before the meeting.
Will we be getting copies of this? Could I get a copy?
Like
of course.
I would like a copy of this.
And I apologize for writing on the letter.
Not necessary.
I might have a clean copy, to be honest with you.
Would you mind introducing yourself, because we are being recorded?
Yeah, absolutely. My name is Bonnie Pudge, and I'm here with Pembroke Town News.
Thank you, Bonnie. Welcome.
Here's a clean copy.
I can keep that?
Yeah,
great.
But as I said, there must be 2 dozen copies around town hall
Plume.
P-L-U-M-E. Okay.
Did I say plum? Yeah.
Maybe one, I don't know if you...
P-L-U-M-E.
Oh.
I forgot the E. I liked plum.
Maybe we have a copy just to put in a... Ms. McSweeney's folder?
Yeah, we can have Sheila take care of that. Sheila, would you mind doing that?
What's up?
Just leave that clean copy out then, Gary. We'll make sure everyone gets it.
Great.
A copy for Gary? Sure.
No, a copy for Gail's folder, who is not here this evening, just so that we all have that information. And I'm actually going to leave this in my correspondence folder, Sheila.
All right.
Okay? And we've got about 20 minutes that we're looking at before we have our first person coming in front of the board. So I'd like to move to old business, and maybe we can get some of these items taken care of. Lisa, under the health agent updates, the 5 now private home health violation, code violations.
All are closed, only one remains open and is still being monitored by the state. We have a potential, I was called on Saturday. We have a potential situation. I'm waiting for more information. I was notified by Pembroke Police on Saturday. While they did not make entry, they had observed concerns regarding a woman and a child. My understanding is the state is also involved on that case. I am waiting to hear from, hopefully, the state agency whether or not my involvement is necessary at this point.
Okay.
Because there's a minor involved, that's how the state...
So of the 5 private home health code violations...
4 are absolutely closed, and 1 is being handled by the state still at this time.
Okay, and then a potential, another one.
There is a potential new case. And of the 4 that are closed, that means their immediate habitation, one of them still has a failed septic, but an engineering firm has been retained And hopefully work will be get on that in the next couple of weeks to figure out what they're going to do to remediate that.
Okay.
But the home itself is safe enough.
All right, and that'll just swing us right into the septic outbreak at two Pembroke establishments.
Talk to the engineering firms again. One of those establishments is virtually closed for the next foreseeable couple of months. They're planning on opening up again in the spring. They will be in with their plan in the spring. They're just waiting for some information from the planning board. The other it has an engineering firm retained. They are actively remediating the problem. So fingers crossed they too will be all set in a short period of time.
Which is the one that is closed?
The sports complex is only open for very, very light use. The hospital, they, like I said, they have an engineer on firm. They're handling everything with their sewage treatment plant at this point, and they're working on their field remediation project.
Okay. And Gary, if I'm going too fast, please feel free to hop right in there and slow me down.
Thank
How about
you.
Your office activity, Ms. Cavity?
We've been jammed.
Mm.
We have been insanely busy in here. That's all I can say. Insanely,
okay.
Just foot traffic, different assistance programs. Advise the board that there has been an application submitted for a 40B on Water Street.
Mm-hmm.
I've spent an enormous amount of time poring over those files myself to help plan the town's response. I have also spent an enormous amount of time with residents as they've come in with questions. Unfortunately, I have people on hand in the building that can read blueprints and explain to someone what they are looking at with that project. I am one of the few available to do so. With the board's blessing, it is not strictly part of my job description to provide information on a 40B project, but I've been asked by both the assistant to the Board of Selectmen as well as the town administrator to assist in that capacity, as I can answer questions that others can't, unfortunately.
Weren't we pretty close to the 40B percentage requirement?
We were at 9.6 as far as I know, but we are still too low.
Okay. 9.6?
Yeah.
Would this one put us over and put us
that
above that 10%?
I would expect that it would.
Mm, okay. I do want to acknowledge Arthur Boyle, who has just come in. Arthur, I don't know if you are here to speak to the board or just to listen before your meeting. I just want to give you...
It says something delivered to the board before our meeting.
Okay.
And it's the open meeting law complaint answer in the case of Gail McSweeney versus the Board of Selectmen. And I'll just read it to you very quickly.
Is this the Mr.
Boyle? I do recognize Arthur Boyle to be able to read this to the board.
We find that the Board of Selectmen did not violate the open meeting law. We now consider the complaint addressed by this determination to be resolved.
Okay,
we have a
thank
copy
you.
For you.
Wonderful. And I'll
thank
make
you.
Sure that we get a copy of that attached to our minutes. Thank
okay.
you for sharing that with us.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I'm the
author. Wonderful.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. I'm glad everything worked out.
As am I.
So that one is now put to rest. Okay, so I did acknowledge Arthur. Arthur is going to be going off to his meeting.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, for your indulgence.
You're welcome. So you've been crazy busy.
Yeah.
The 40B.
I love saying this to you because I'm saying the obvious. Obviously, the 40B is going to take up an enormous amount of time. The other thing that's starting to take up more time, again, with the board's permission, not all of this is strictly my job responsibility, but certainly environmental health and wellness absolutely is. The Furnace Pond dredging project, I went with the town treasurer collector, the town administrator, and a few others to meet with the Brockton Water Department to discuss the dredging of Furnace Pond, to seek their support. We made some wonderful connections over there. My understanding is we will have the support of the Brockton Water Commissioners if we need it. I sincerely hope that's the case. Furthermore, there's going to be another meeting on Wednesday regarding that project with our engineering firm to finalize numbers and feasibility if we can make this project happen. I don't need to tell anyone this will be scientifically speaking, engineering-wise and town-wise, it will be challenging and it will be expensive.
Mm-hmm.
We're hoping to remediate that somewhat with the sale of the material we will remove from the pond. But I'm one of the few people in the town, again, with the expertise in this area, the knowledge about the watershed and everything else to be of assistance. So with the board's permission, I will continue to assist the town administrator and the treasurer collector in this project. And I always feel funny saying this to you, considering you are a realtor, but the amount of property still exchanging hands, coming on the market, and almost immediately selling in Pembroke, it blows my mind. It seems like houses are almost sold before they even hit the market.
Yep.
That seems to be continuing. While it's wonderful, it also creates a lot of work around here. The last part is one of the last pieces of property with open complaints for vacancy. I'm told, I just met someone who claims to be the new owner of it, that will bring us down to one highly complained about vacant piece of property in Pembroke. If you remember, just a year ago at this time, Madam Chair, I believe we had about 24 of them.
Mm-hmm.
Almost all of them have been sold, liquidated to either homeowners that have moved in and renovated, or people that have flipped the homes, or property that's been repurposed. It's really nice from a public health perspective. Blighted properties present a public health nuisance as well as a general nuisance to any neighborhood. And we've all but eliminated them in the immediate Pembroke area, which is absolutely wonderful.
Can I just ask for the street of the one vacant?
Yes, the vacant.
The only one.
I can state it. The Mattakeeson Street.
Okay.
I'm fingers crossed that the person that came in to present themselves as the potential new owner and the rehabber of that project has rehabbed many homes in Pembroke, so I cannot think that this is not valid information.
And then we might be at a zero.
From your lips to God's ears, would that not make me the happiest health agent in the South?
On that vacant property, there's not a septic issue that you're aware of, is there?
No, it's always a challenge, though, with vacant properties. Unfortunately, sometimes when people no longer retain ownership of the property, this causes them to make choices that are counterproductive to the property, so there's never a guarantee with these vacant and foreclosed homes. I'm sincerely hoping there's no significant damage to the septic, but it's never a guarantee.
We do have a new person who has come in, sir. Would you mind introducing yourself, because we are being recorded?
It's Jeffrey Alanesian.
Okay. All right, Lisa, keep up the good work. I do think it's important. I am actually, I don't even know if I have to, but I think I would like to take a vote in regards to, and I know that a job description is coming up, and I would think that these things, the dredging of Furnace Pond, as well as being able to offer the town specific insight into 40Bs and septics, which is why we have you here, I would like to see that we have those added under a job description as any action that the board so feels you should be involved in. I don't necessarily know if they should be added as line items, but I think that
case-by-case consulting.
Right, and I think that's what we have a lot of.
Right, I just want the board to understand where my time is going, and I want you to approve of it. And by all means, if the board does not approve of my spending time on some of these projects, I mean, none of these are job description items. The Furnace Pond dredging won't go on forever,
right.
And if we don't have the funding for it, it'll end immediately. Therefore, it's not really a job description item. It's a project. It's an action project, as would be any 40B project. They're not going to be ongoing. A project, by its definition, will start and end.
Mm-hmm.
I just want the board to understand that anything that's outside my immediate scope, I will bring to the board and bring to the attention the time it takes to do these things to make sure that that is how the board wants my time spent.
So I think I would like to make a motion to allow our health agent to continue being involved in the Furnace Pond dredging issue, along with the watershed and the Brockton Water Commission, as well as being a reference point for the town of Pembroke in regards to the 40B that has been requested for Water Street. These are things that we will ask of our health agent at different times as different things come up under a job description. So I think that those two items should fall under an as seen necessity by the sitting board. Do I hear a second, or would you like to add to that? Do you have anything to say about it? There's two points of issue that Lisa is currently going to be involved in that is outside the scope.
Lisa, our health agent's job description.
Correct.
Now that she has a new contract we as a board need to take up her job description, which we have discussed in the past few weeks. In relationship to your motion about adding those particular items, the dredging, the being a resource on 40B, I can certainly second that motion, adding them to the current job description.
Okay.
And I understand that that other document is not done and I expect it to change. What I don't want to do is either not work on these projects or not assist with them in the 2 weeks or 4 weeks or whatever time frame it takes us to get to that other document. I just want you to be aware of what I'm doing.
Absolutely.
And I want you to endorse it. That's all.
And thank you for keeping us apprised.
May it interest the board, there is a walkthrough of that project that
Wednesday.
The town will be on at 2 p.m. If you wished to go, you would certainly be welcome to.
Is that the crossover of 139, that
Correct.
Part of Water Street?
It's sometimes referred to as the Water Street extension. It strictly isn't, but yes, that is exactly.
And that heads right down to
Correct.
The condominium.
Correct. At the very end of that would be
Packet Landed. Thank you.
I apologize.
This is the rescheduled date? I know they had
Correct.
Another date that
they
were talking about.
This is the latest date that I was under the understanding of. That is the last email memo I've gotten is 2 p.m. this one.
And confirm, will you be on site at 2
I
o'clock?
I absolutely intend to be, barring any kind of major problem, but yes.
Okay, perfect.
The furnace pond
and
dredging project
is invited.
Will be discussed at
yeah.
9 a.m.
Okay.
That is my project for the afternoon, and right now those are my two hot-button items because of... And obviously, I think that those, you know, have to be high-attention or hot-button items. They're the number one concerns of people walking through the door in this town hall asking questions about them, so I think they're certainly of a high priority to our citizenship.
Mm-hmm.
Have you become the official point person, or?
No, I think I'm not the point person at all. Matter of fact, in both cases, I would say that the Board of Selectmen is. However, I guess I would applaud the Board of Selectmen when you have a resource or a tool that understands some aspects of a project perhaps better than you. I think it's a wonderful sign that our town administrator and our treasurer collector reach out to those resources and ask for help in that. You know, obviously I work a lot with engineers, and I don't think that it's lost on anyone that I have a geological and hydrogeological background, which
mm-hmm.
on both of these projects obviously lends itself to it very well.
That's it's a wonderful caveat to have. We're very fortunate that you have that. I made a motion. Gary did accept it, so all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Moving on, the 13 points of interest pertaining to the local regulation upgrades, I think at this point, because we have...
I haven't done much with it because I did do the government study. I took a light
okay.
stab. You'll see that in your packet. I don't
Saw
think
that.
You need to discuss
yep.
it tonight, but I think the board members, and hopefully Ms. McSweeney will have a chance to get in between now and the other meeting and pick up her package. What I wanted is that was literally a first blush, you know, what came to my head as I was asked those questions. By all means, this is your board. Change, amend... you hate it, you disagree with me, you love it, it's exactly what you were thinking, but I just wanted the board members to have it to take home, to look at it, to consider the ideas on there and consider if that's what they want before we turn it into the town study committee.
Off the top of your head, when were they looking for an official response?
I have not found anything, but as far as I know, most of the departments I've spoken to are either working on it, partially finished with it. I don't think anyone has turned in a wildly complete document at this point. If I'm wrong, I'll stand corrected.
So we can take a look at that this week. Can we put that on the agenda for next week?
I would love to. First of all, I want to table the 13 points of interest pertaining to for the next
yeah.
meeting.
Yeah, okay.
And then we would like to, I would like to ask each member to read over and be prepared for comments and discussion on the town study questionnaire that Lisa has filled out for our next meeting.
And
that
last
should
point,
take
if I may,
us.
Madam Chair, the other thing that you may wish to take a look, we talked about, you know, SurveyMonkey and plastic bags, and I decided to torture myself and read like 35 plastic bag initiatives
mm-hmm.
to say that different parts of the country and different parts of even the state are all over the place would be an understatement. So what I did is I tried to pick three local and most similar to what I would have imagined a bag initiative in Pembroke would have looked like. I created a dummy Survey Monkey for the cover for you of what a couple different, either a really simplistic or a much
survey
more detailed monkey
yes.
might look
yes.
like. And then I put on the actual initiatives of three other communities. What I found the most interesting about those three communities, I think Plymouth's initiative is most similar to what Pembroke would be ideally thinking of, But the reason I did put in Dennis is I thought it was interesting that Dennis actually did it as a town meeting article, not a vote of the Board of Health. All three are there. Look them over. Consider them. Mm. Consider the Survey Monkey ideas. Consider if you want to go that route. And we could, again, discuss that at a future meeting and then set up the Survey Monkey if that's the board's desire.
So which town did it as a town meeting? Dennis?
Dennis. I thought that was interesting.
I think that's very interesting.
And I don't think that's necessarily a bad idea either. And simple support of an article by any board and submitted for town meeting would be enough to put it on town meeting floor.
Okay. If we approve some questions, just hypothetically at our next meeting, 2 weeks from this evening,
mm-hmm.
how quickly can you get it out on SurveyMonkey? I mean, within
24
hours. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Deb Wall has an open account. My understanding is Deb Wall has an open, and the reason SurveyMonkey, I don't want anyone to think we just, are favoring one company. There's an open account with them. We've used them in the past for recycling bins and other town programs. It's because she has an open account, so she can create these SurveyMonkeys
right.
At will.
Okay.
So we'll put that on next week's agenda.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And
then
now
we
I think
can
you're just about there for 7 o'clock for our 7 o'clock presentation.
Okay, so we can also read through the plastic bag of
yep.
both towns.
Yeah,
so we
and
have
and
two.
We have
two items for homework. So real quick, I just want to ask a question. Cannabis committee update, have you been notified yet?
I have not been notified. I did speak to our health agent last week about it, and I don't want to speak for you, Lisa,
no.
but I believe you also echo that Chief Wall has been busy with a lot of other issues end
he
of the year.
Putting it together was his active words, but nothing has been done yet.
My thought with the state postponing and thinking of drafting their own legislation, this may be somewhat on the back burner. But
I would imagine that's probably the case. I would agree.
So no official
so no,
update at the moment.
Nothing as of yet.
Yep.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. And I believe it's 7 o'clock. I believe you are Lisa Wells.
Yes. Thank
okay,
you for
Lisa,
having me.
Thank you for coming. I think you understand at our last meeting we had a pediatrician come in.
Yes.
The selectmen have asked us to what our opinion is on the raising of the drinking age.
Tobacco.
To
21,
yeah.
Drinking
well?
Is 21.
I know.
It's
I apologize. It's been a very long day with a sinus headache. The tobacco, raising it to 21. So we felt that it was more important that we really kind of listen to both sides. We're not prepared to make any type of a vote or a decision, but we just wanted to have you come in and be able to explain to us why it should stay 18 or why it should be moved.
Before Ms. Wells speaks on the issue, could you, and I can see I'm looking at the agenda, it says you're a representative from Smoke and Ashes.
Yes.
Can you just give us a little bit of your background and your, what, not, and I'm not saying that you said you're an expert on the matter, but just what's your background?
I am the company manager.
Okay.
So my background will be more based on retail and business,
okay.
not on health implications.
And have you appeared before other boards of health?
I have not.
You have not? Oh, okay. Well, welcome.
That's not something I generally do.
Okay.
Usually in the office. So.
Oh, thank you for coming.
So do you want me just to kind of...
We would,
okay.
please.
I mean, I guess I would start off by saying that we understand. There's nobody in the room who doesn't understand the risks of smoking. I think that that's a given. I don't think that it's something that we're going to try to say, no, this is good or anything like that. So know that on the outside that we, you know, I understand, we all understand. But it is an adult decision, and that would be our position on it. Is you are an adult at 18, you should be allowed to make your adult decisions at 18. And mm-hmm. I understand that drinking is at 21 and marijuana is at 21, you know, McDonald's is free for anybody, all of these things are not healthy, all of these things are risky.
Mm-hmm.
So really, I guess I would say the point that we would like to make is it is an adult decision to make. We appreciate you being willing to hear two sides versus just kind of following along. We also understand that that's the direction the country is moving in.
Mm-hmm.
Town by town by town, it's kind of being brought to towns. I do feel like it's something that belongs at a state level because if it were at the state level, it levels the playing field for everybody as it is now. If one town is 21 and the town next door is 18, the town that's 18 automatically has an edge in business, and that's not really fair business practice. It's not giving everybody the same level playing field. Mm-hmm. So doing it town by town is probably not the approach that we would argue should be taking. If you're going to do 21, then make Massachusetts 21. Mm-hmm. We're all back on the same playing field, and then we can continue on with business. Okay. My kind of second and I would say more pressing concern is that it's often not when these regulations are passed, it's not simply tobacco will be 21.
Right.
It's tobacco will be 21. And age of entry in a store now, is that 21? What defines an adult retail establishment? What can you or can you not sell in your store? All of these things that kind of dovetail into the law, and usually the laws, if you read town by town by town, they read exactly the same. It's kind of very neatly presented to you. It's been vetted. This is what mm-hmm. the law reads like. All you have to do is enact it. It's easy for somebody in your seat to do that. We definitely need to argue for our right to still do business. If you're going to go 21 with tobacco, that's fine. But we're 18 plus, and we really request that we are allowed to continue to do basic adult business at 18 plus. If you're an adult and a tobacco product is 21, that's fine. You should be able to buy all tobacco products. There shouldn't be no blunt wraps. There shouldn't be no flavor mm-hmm. bans, things like that. It's just we would ask that we're still allowed to do our business.
Okay. Because we were presented, there is a Massachusetts tobacco sale age map. And
kind of sitting in the middle is the only.
Yeah, I think the
I believe
Hanson also is yes. not 21 yet.
Maybe Halifax?
No, Halifax is.
Halifax
yeah.
is. Okay.
So that was something that, had been brought to us. One of the things that Gary and I are very proud of that several years ago, the e-cigarettes. There was no age requirement put on the e-cigarettes. So we passed a law making it 18 before the state went and did it because there were no guidelines on that. One of the things on the e-cigarettes and one of my concerns, and I haven't been in a smoke shop for quite some time, and I went and did a little, I was out doing errands today, and I stopped in and I visited. I visited Brennan Smoke Shop. I said who I was. I didn't go in under false pretense. I did not go out on public duty. I went in for my as a taxpayer of Pembroke. I was very pleasantly surprised. And I think one of the things that I know that the e-cigarettes and the liquids are used as a stop smoking.
It's an alternative. Right.
What I wasn't seeing, and I didn't ask, was any type of the Nicorette gum and the other types and forms of things that are sold in, like a CVS or a Walmart. Okay, and none of those products were there to go along with giving a bigger variety, which was just something I observed.
Good point.
The other thing that really concerned me was, and I didn't get a chance to Google CBDs. I know that there is one store that particularly had gummy packages. Mm-hmm. They're made of hemp,
right.
Which is without, and I think I kind of got a great little education today, which I greatly applaud. That it doesn't have the THC in it. Thank you. It used to be by itself.
I can't speak to Brennan's. I honestly haven't been in Brennan's in a few months. I mm-hmm. don't know what they have. Clearly, a smoke shop is a smoke shop. We're all pretty much, mm-hmm. I would say, pretty level playing field in
yep.
what we carry. The CBD, it has come up as a big question. What is this product? Is it legal? What is it made of? The DEA has actually just kind of put down some new, clearer regulations on CBD.
Mm-hmm.
The CBD that is fully legal in all 50 states, is made, has to be made from the hemp plant. Only the root or the stock. It can't be anything to do with flour or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
There are standards that it has to be, I think it's 0.003 or less THC. So it's completely not psychoreactive. What it does offer people, in theory, it's a supplement. So just like taking a vitamin or anything else, I think you can argue whether it is, it does anything or if it's
exactly
not.
And that's an adult is choosing
it's,
to do
it's,
that.
You know, it's supposed to add some feelings of calmness. It does an awful lot for pain relief. It does an awful lot for people with epilepsy and seizures. And
mm-hmm.
you'll find, if you research into it, that's what a lot of people actually use it for. It's prescribed a lot for animals as well, small animals that have seizure disorders or whatever. It's however it works, and I'm not a scientist.
Mm-hmm.
It kind of just brings that level down. It eases pain without having to go into prescription pain medication.
Right. Okay.
But it is, technically it is considered a supplement. It gets into that gray area of you need to have a retail food license, maybe because it looks like it's candy, but it's not really defined as
mm-hmm.
such.
Right.
Which is also something that's usually written in the definition of adult tobacco store. It says, I believe the words are, not required to have a retail food license. Certainly, we should still be able to have a retail food license so that we can carry gum and mint and any of those little gummies.
Mm-hmm.
It shouldn't be something that's prohibited in the law. It is something I'm kind of dealing with Whitman on right now.
Okay.
Not required does not mean not allowed.
And I think I just have one more question before I turn it over to Gary. If you were to, you know, there's a lot of different things that can be sold in a smoke shop.
Right.
There's all kinds of different products and some stuff that I don't even know what it is. But a lot of stuff, you know, I remember when. So my question is, is there the age restriction, okay, I believe in a smoke shop, right, you have to be 18 to enter, is that... Am I...
By definition of an adult retail tobacco store, yes.
Okay. And that would constitute what we have in Pembroke up by the Duxbury line.
Yes.
The other store.
Yes.
Which was closed today. Okay. So the...
Always closed on Monday.
Okay. Good. Good. So the percentage of people coming through the door aren't allowed in that store. Are they... What's the percentage of 18-year-olds versus 21 and above? Do you know that statistic or what your sales are showing?
Well, I mean, sales are just sales. We
mm-hmm.
don't
it's not earmark, broken.
Like, that we sold this product to an 18-year-old. That particular store, she is very few of the under 21 crowd because that's really off the beaten path. Our big business is the lunch hour. And hopefully when spring hits, the golfing on weekends, you know, obviously we're hoping that that's a really cigar-heavy store, and that's really designed to be the Duxbury professional. That's what the hope is for that store.
Mm-hmm.
We do have, you know, other stores in other towns, and basically we are an 18-plus. The law states anybody under the age of 27, we put it at 30. If they look young and they come in the store, if there's any question, I'm just going to need to see an ID. Like, long before a transaction takes place,
mm-hmm.
we know we're not stores for kids. We don't want to be stores for kids. I mean, I have a 17 and an 18-year-old. I understand the very fine line that we walk. Dave
mm-hmm.
and Lisa Brennan live in Pembroke. They have 3 kids.
Mm-hmm.
We don't, that's not the business we're in. And, you know, if you have a group of, say, 4 kids come in and 3 have IDs and 1 doesn't, the one without the ID needs to leave the store. Like, that's a zero tolerance policy in our stores.
Okay. All right. Gary?
The last question that you asked was on my mind. You know, hypothetically, Lisa, what do you think it would do to your business if Pembroke went to a T21? And clearly you see where the trend is headed. You know, we've got a third, a third of the communities in the state have already gone to T21. A lot of other communities are looking at it right now.
We lost Whitman store because they went 21 plus November 1st. In the first 2 months, we've dropped probably about $4,000, which maybe sounds like, oh, it's not that much. We're a small business. That's a lot.
I have a small business. That'd be a lot for me.
It's significant. It takes, you know, a couple days' sales right out of the picture.
Okay. So clearly,
I don't want to say devastating, but in the course of a year, you know, tobacco sales are going down. We know that. That's due to education. That's due to people, you know, making other choices. We're bringing in socks. We're bringing in T-shirts. We're bringing in whatever else. And that kind of pop culture-y, that kind of, you know, like a sock with a marijuana leaf on it, those are popular for that 18 to 21-year-old segment. And again, if you own a business, you know that's a $10 sale. That's a $20 sale.
Sure.
You've got to make that business up somewhere. And that's when you go to 21 to enter, we lose that pop culture where our business is actually growing. And we're not getting it back. So we kind of get in that position where we almost feel like we're being forced out of business because we're willing to change our perspective, but our hands are held. We can't pursue other avenues because we're not allowed to be free market and sell those products. And that's, again, that goes back to the greater concern, less on 21, more on let me continue to do business.
So what happens when the state goes and changes it?
Then again, I guess it levels the playing field a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
We have to continue to adapt.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully, at that point, we will have found some other business avenues that make sense for us. The state going to 21 again, is that going to be age of entry? It's a question mark.
Right.
I don't have an answer for that.
Mm-hmm.
We would continue to argue that that's not the direction we'd want to go, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
No further questions.
Okay. No, I think I'm good. Thank you very much. I greatly appreciate you coming in.
Thank you for taking the time to look at both sides.
We appreciate that. And actually, that was Mr. Fine's recommendation that, in fact, we do look at both sides because it is a hot topic. It is a health issue or a concern. So we now have both sides and both information. One thing I wanted to add, I know that Gregory is here.
Jeffrey.
Jeffrey, thank you, I'm sorry. Jeffrey, you would like to be on our agenda for February 6th?
If it's okay with the board, we could just talk today. I won't show up too much of your time.
Well, you're here, why don't
I'm an expert.
You're an expert.
Wow.
On tobacco retail and tobacco in general in the state of Massachusetts. I've sat on a number of public health committees up at the State House. Not on the committees, I've testified in front of a number of public health committees, revenue committees, boards of health. I think we sat with you guys the last time this came around.
Mm-hmm.
Our stance on 21 plus is we don't see kids coming in our stores. We see full-grown adults, and the 21 plus isn't going to affect our business at all. It's really not. We see very few. And I have a lot of data here. Just a few things I'd like to read. 84% of tobacco retailers are in compliance between 2014. 95% of alcohol retailers are in compliance. 16% of Massachusetts high school students currently use cigarettes, cigars, and smokeless tobacco. 34% of Massachusetts high school students currently consume alcohol. 28% of high school students have tried smoking. 61% of high school students have tried consuming alcohol. 4% of high school students have tried smoking before the age of 13. 13% of Massachusetts high school students have tried alcohol before age 13. Just some statistics, and I brought you guys
mm-hmm.
some copies. I know I'm not on the agenda today.
I know you're not, and I am allowing you to speak.
Just a little bit.
You're here.
We're for the 21 plus. The only time we ever have a problem with people without IDs is 18, 19, and 20-year-olds. They get heated. We have arguments with them. I just assume, fine, 21 plus. Where our fear is the flavor ban. We've been through this before in a number of public health hearings. I've got in here a bag, and there must be 20 different flavors of alcohol. The difference, and on these sheets, I don't hand it, you guys can look at it later. The difference between a liquor store and a tobacco store is we can't let minors in our store. And the only reason we can't let minors in the store is because we have self-service tobacco displays. If you have self-service tobacco displays, you can't let anybody under 18 in your store. Okay? You guys are talking 21. Our self-service tobacco display is our walk-in humidors. Men, women can walk in, select the cigars that they want, and walk out and purchase mm-hmm. them. If you're going to, and we're pretty sure it's going to happen, and we're not going to buck the system. It's going to happen statewide eventually. Maybe not this session, next session, it's going to happen. We just, for instance, Marshfield went one step further. Not only say, hey, 21's an adult, but now that you're an adult, you can't buy flavored tobacco. Well, wait a second. I'm an adult. I should be able to buy the 20 different flavors of nips, of vodka. I should be able to, you know, vote. Cherry blunts, and now we're talking about, and can I go on the record, when you guys start talking about recreational marijuana, we'd like to be first in line, because from our perspective, there's nobody in Pembroke that's more qualified to sell that product. We've been dealing with tobacco regulations for, I don't know, 25 years, almost 15 years in the town of Pembroke. We've been through the possession with intent to distribute drug paraphernalia in the town of Pembroke. I don't know if you guys remember that. Pembroke mm-hmm. police pressed charges. Mm-hmm. We fought it. So it's a very controversial issue. We're on one side, you're saying, hey, you're going to be 21. And we figure you're teeing up the balls for us to be able to sell recreational marijuana. 21 plus. Makes sense, right? We've been dealing with the age restrictions on tobacco for many years. On the other hand, we're afraid that you're going to start telling adults what they can and can't purchase. We don't have a problem with 21 plus. Our problem is with flavor ban, minimum packaging, pricing. You know, in Brockton we deal with two cigarette sales. They have to be a minimum of $5. So kind of counterproductive in terms of public health, because now full-blown adults, 21 plus, are not buying just one pack of cigarillos for $5. They're buying the whole box. That way they get the $1.50 a pack, because it's a package price. One package has to be at least $5. Once they buy the box is a package, then they get the $1.50 per pack of cigarillos. We also want to thank you for giving us the opportunity to speak, and really want to go on record. There is nobody. It doesn't make sense to me to have a liquor store retailing marijuana. The primary way of ingesting marijuana is by smoking it. In our opinion, vaping is smoking. The act of putting something up to your face, inhaling it, and then exhaling it, that's smoking. Debate that all day. So if the primary method of ingesting marijuana is smoking, it only makes sense that smoke shops should be able to sell it recreationally.
Well, you are on record, not only in the minutes, but actually on both cable and Pembroke News. That's not a decision that I believe the Board of Health is going to make in regards to who is going to be issued licenses to be able to sell, but you certainly had a great platform to be able to throw that out. I don't believe that that will be our decision to make, and I don't know when the state's going to be able to figure all of that out.
It's going
to
be a bit.
Right. So right now, you are quite welcome. I think I can speak for Mr. Fine. Thank you for coming in, and we will keep you posted.
I just want to get a clarification from you, Jeff. So if you could wave your magic wand and you were sitting here, open seat, you'd be more than content to see it go to T21. It's the flavor that you're concerned with.
And pricing.
And the minimum pricing.
Okay.
You're not only telling us who we can let into our store, you're telling us what we can then sell it to. And then you're telling us what we can and can't sell it for. It's kind of, you know, just last week, Rainham Board of Health actually sent a letter out to all of the tobacco retailers in the town to go 21 plus. They had no other regulations. It was just 21. We were the only ones to show up. Because I think that the majority of tobacco retailers know it's going to go to 21. It is what it is.
As we continue to look at this further, and I think you referred to this, Ms. Wells, if we are proceeding further with the T21 ban, there is a cafeteria-style menu, if you will, in terms of what we will allow, what we won't allow. So the flavoring, that is one of the...
Flavoring and the minimum pricing.
And just so you guys are clear, I saw the Dr. Hartman. I've debated this issue with Dr. Winnikoff. All right. They actually did the research, I'm pretty sure, on this. From my perspective, when I was 30, I was still adolescent. I didn't become an adult until I had kids. I have a 2 and a 3 year old now. I'm 40 years old. Even when I was 37, I was still adolescent. I don't think you're cognitive enough to make a wise decision until you have another life in your responsibility. You know, that's what really, responsibility is what makes an adult. Funny thing, I want you guys to go to my Brennan's Facebook page. I got a picture of a landing vehicle in Normandy. And you, 18-year-old, 17-year-old, young people, they are kids. And this picture is compelling because it's at the front of the landing craft, and they're all kids. They're kids. Some of them might, you know, back then they lied about their age to get in the service, but, you know, it's tough because do you then say, okay, 18's not old enough to vote. Mm-hmm. 18's not old enough. You think about how the armed services recruit kids to join the service. They recruit them. They may have to kill people, and they may have to die defending us. But they're at the high school. They're in the high school, you know, trying to recruit kids. So this, and the only thing I've ever said about Dr. Harbin's research is that this can go other places, and it can, you know. The data is indisputable. I mean, it is what it is. I mean, I've read his research. It's great, but there's other things. For instance, the sudden infant death syndrome that he attributes to secondhand smoke. Mm-hmm. Well, now they're saying 90% of those SIDS cases, there was a blanket or a stuffed animal in the crib when that baby suffered from sudden infant death syndrome. So statistics, math, you know, it depends on which direction you're looking at it. I never used the good doctor's name in vain. I just debate the issue as any, you know, we're in business, we're on the other side. You know, this is America, and we're able to do so. Thank God. So,
it was very important to have both sides come and speak before the board before we take this matter up further. So, Lisa, thank you for coming in. Jeff, also thank you for coming in.
Thank you for having us.
And I think you are.
This is my mom, Karen for the record.
Yep, I think Karen was here before. All right. Well, thank you.
Thank you, board.
Thank you. All three.
You guys want these? You want the maps?
Yeah.
You want? The last time.
For study purposes.
Yeah. The last time, and this is what Dr. Harmon was speaking of, I got up there at the State House, with the Public Health Committee at the State House, and I lined them up. Whipped cream, it goes on and on. But the thing is, you hear Dr. Hartman talk about the display. They're right out there for kids. We don't see kids in our store. Mm-hmm. We see adults. These are right on the counter, right next door to my store. These are all different flavors. I'm not going to talk them up. Just
okay,
to give
good.
You an example.
Yeah. I got you.
All right on the right on the counter. So that's our thing. We just don't want to see. We're here to stand up for adults like to choose. Enjoy those, you guys.
Take care.
All right, thank you. You're 21, right?
I think you better card him. Look at you.
I think he looks over 30.
Are we going to put those with that paraphernalia?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, put them all together.
Okay.
All right, wonderful. Well, that was very, very enlightening.
I have to be honest with the board. I'm not terribly surprised because I'm pretty sure that Jeffrey's gone on the record at our last meeting that he was not entirely opposed to the age raising, but I do understand their arguments about flavorings and single cells.
Exactly.
That there is a demand for that from an adult clientele, and it mm-hmm. is not any more appropriate than an adult person that wants a nip versus a pint versus a larger container of alcohol. I admire that they understand our concerns from... being the Board of Health, you have to be concerned about health.
Right.
Obviously, we would prefer no people smoke as it is unhealthy. However, you know, from the health optics, if you would, right. you have to be concerned about them.
Jeff and his mom came, I think, when I attended a public hearing that Josh Cutler was sponsoring mm-hmm. in Duxbury.
Yep.
He also spoke, and I don't think his position has changed all that much. You know, he was in favor of the 21. It was the flavors that he was concerned about.
Right, and the flavors became an issue.
Yeah. And we, you know, looking back what we did a year and a half ago when we made the age from no age for e-cigarettes to 18,
mm-hmm.
We didn't do anything with the flavoring bans at the time.
Right, and I don't believe so. And I'm trying to go through my memory bank here in regards to, we actually had one that we fine-tuned from, I don't remember what policy we were dealing with, but
Cheryl
we had...
Okay. Cheryl Sabara came in with her, and I...
And we could pick and choose of yeah. what we wanted to...
We've been playing tag back and forth, but
okay.
if it's the board's wish strictly to raise the age to purchase to 21, I'm confident she has a template.
Okay.
Available.
And that could be a pick and choose at some point.
Correct.
So.
And then, okay. and then there's the 21 similar. To yeah. enter, which is completely dependent. That the state statute says 21 to enter, as Jeffrey correctly pointed out, for self-service.
Mm.
And that's the reason his stores are 20, because he does have loose and self-service directly out where the public can see and touch it. The other smoke shop, Smoke and Ashes, does not have product directly out. Therefore, a raise in purchase to 21 would not prohibit 18 to 21-year-olds from going into their store just
any
for
age.
Purchasing tobacco.
Any age.
Correct. It would not prevent them from going in just from purchasing for obvious reasons. So there's that to consider. Do you want to restrict access or
mm-hmm.
merely purchasing? And based on that, I'm going to assume, but correct me if I'm wrong, none of the board members have brought up flavors or selling singles or the mini Lolos or Cigarolos or anything. No one suggested, you know, prohibiting those, so I didn't think the board was even thinking in that direction. So basically, those are the two questions being asked of you, if you want to consider those two items.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, well, I definitely think
then
that they can come up
with... Cheryl for that.
Thank you. I think that can continue to stay, maybe not necessarily as an agenda item for our next meeting, but certainly in a meeting to come. Okay, so we are moving right along. The Town Administrator Selectman on the Plastic Bag Initiative, we already did kind of hop into that before when we were talking. So the other thing that I want to bring up is we had discussion. I have given a correspondence out, which I had mentioned in the beginning to each person, which was an email that I reached out to after our last meeting. I actually had a face-to-face conversation with Carolyn Murray in regards to the question of whether a job description and a contract need to be bound together and be considered one document. The question that I proposed to council reads as follows. I'm looking to see if you've been able to confirm what the law is in regard to the contract and job description for the Board of Health agent position. I feel that these two documents are each separate living contracts. Thank you. Her response, which she came back to me, I do have this as an attachment to our minutes, and each member has it, as well as the health agent and Sheila.
Yes.
Her response to us is, there is no legal requirement that I am aware of linking the job description to a contract. I also asked the head of our contracts department and labor department, as well as Pembroke's primary attorney, for the past several years, and no one could point to any opinion to this effect which our firm allegedly issued. So I am unable to locate the document that the other member of the Board of Health was referring to at your meeting. Period. Carolyn Murray, Esquire, KMP Law.
Madam Chair,
Yes.
I am not an attorney. I do have a legal background, and I know when the topic of our health agent's contract, or the renewal of a three-year contract, came up, perhaps in the early fall of 2016, there was some discussion about not only the contract, but the job description. I have stated from day one that clearly both our health agent's contract and the job description are critical and should be on file, should be reviewed by all three members of the board. But I have stated from day one that they are two separate documents. So it's nice to see that Ms. Murray from KP Law has echoed my sentiments. And I do think we need to do some work on the health agent's job description, but it's nice to see that that she validated some of the concerns that or points that I was making several months ago.
Correct, and you have, and I can attest to that. So with that being said, I think it's important when a statement is made, we are not a responsible board if we do not investigate what is being presented to us as fact, that we need to go further and we need to investigate more, which is what I took upon as the chairperson. There was a piece of paper. It was not shared with the rest of this board that statements were made. It is the opinion of our town council in writing to Pembroke that there is no such requirement. So therefore, from the last meeting that we held, Lisa Cullity, it was voted that she will be our health agent, and we will renew her contract that she has with the town of Pembroke, which will be in effect for 3 years. The second item is her job description, which fluctuates over the years. So currently on our agenda, we have the job description discussion, where we do not have our third board member here. I am asking whether we want to take it up or we would like to move it and table it for our next meeting.
I'd like to make a motion to table the job description for our next meeting 2 weeks from this evening.
Okay. I will second that. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
It has been tabled for our next meeting. At that time, Sheila, will you please make sure we have a full copy once again? I know that we all have it, but just in case somebody doesn't bring it with them or has a chance, if you could send that all out to everyone to review. I'd like, that is our third homework assignment for the next meeting.
Will do.
Okay. As for new business, there was a request in regards to, now we have five outbreaks, that we have a form created in regards to recording and reporting private home health violation codes to the board.
I'm going to work up a, what I'd like to do is work up a spreadsheet of some sort for that exact purpose. Date of incident, date of closure, you know, an address of sorts. We can just leave off, you know, the house number to preserve the rights and privacy of the individuals affected, if that pleases the board.
So if you were to develop a form, and I think it was, I had submitted this item to the chair. And I think not, in fairness to you, I don't think you have ever intentionally given the board short shrift, but I think the way our structure, our meet, short shrift.
Shrift. What is that?
Maybe giving less attention than spending
okay,
less time.
Thank you.
But I think given the structure of our meetings that start at 6:30, there are times that we have somebody coming in for a variance at 6:45. And in your attempt to move things along, you'll try to compact a lot of information between that 6:30 to 6:45 window. And I think there have been times where you're going over a violation and I'm only speaking for myself, Lisa. I'm not getting the gist of what the incident is. So whether it's a form or whether you're reporting, there are certain things that I'd like to see covered there. I guess my question is, if you came out with a form that would be distributed to the board, would you still feel that you would not be comfortable or you would not be able to because of privacy or confidentiality?
Not at all. I was actually thinking, more from a statistical standpoint, the reason I liked your idea so much, and I actually, Sheila and I have been talking about this, by creating an Excel Word spreadsheet, we can keep track of these incidences, where and when they occur. But as you pointed out, it's the dates of opening, dates of closure with a last column that we would just tick off the high incidence of occurrence violations. In other words, what's going wrong the most in the latter part of that. And by identifying the house by street and then having the street numbers, now the street numbers can stay on the computer, but when you produce an Excel spreadsheet, we can blind out one column. So while I can publicly disseminate information, it would prevent someone from being, you know, embarrassed and singled out with the exact address and location of that property. Do you see what I'm saying? In other words, I can give you enough information so you know the location. When if I remember correctly, you wanted the location, you wanted the date of occurrence, and you wanted a brief amount of violations. I was going to create some violation codes for what was going wrong at that particular parcel, and then a date of closure, a date that those were remediated.
And what other agencies? What other agencies were involved?
Absolutely.
Whether it was the state, whether it was the Department of Child Services,
yes.
Mental.
I want to be clear, though. Your interpretation is just as, if not more valuable than a form. So if you are to come up with a form, we'll take a look at it. But I wouldn't want that form to take the place of any sort of discussion. I think having the form and us being able to...
I think supplemental to keep, if you would, keep track.
Yeah.
I think supplemental. I think the board's always going to have to be updated on these incidences and willing that they resolve themselves like these last ones have, as to not leave people in jeopardy and not have to cause undue stress on the parties affected either, or embarrassment. I don't think that's necessary. Obviously, if an issue can't be resolved, it does come before this board, and that's unfortunate for the parties involved, and it's unfortunate for the board because it will leave people in an uncomfortable situation, but we've managed to resolve things in a positive manner up to this point, and God willing, we'll continue to.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think you can have a draft?
Next meeting, yes.
Do you think you could, I'm just throwing this out, you think you might be able to come up with a draft, get it sent to us prior to the next meeting?
I don't see why not.
And then we could maybe take a look at that.
Things are a slight bit quieter now than they've been the last couple of weeks, so I think that's very doable.
Okay, so that'll be for the next meeting.
But it's also, you know, we're just entered a new year. It's a good time to start that and keep track of those by the calendar year.
Right, which is what we kind of wanted to do, and just kind of now that we've got everything kind of...
And then we can store them by
rolling a little bit forward.
And I think that's a very positive move.
Can we just back up for just a minute before you move to the next topic?
Sure.
When we thanked our guests who came in and spoke on the T21, did I hear you say that you did not want to put that on the agenda for next week? I wasn't clear.
I don't think we need to put it on the agenda, but if you would like to put it on the agenda, would we like to further discuss it?
I'd like to see it on the agenda for next week. That's my own 2 cents.
Okay. Then I would be more than happy.
Great, thank you.
To have that put on the agenda. Will you be bringing back the brown paper bag?
Okay.
Okay, great.
Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry.
I said, will you be bringing back the brown paper bag?
I actually thought I would leave it here in the office. I don't think I would be taking that home with me.
There you go. There you go.
All right. I missed that attempt at humor, Madam Chair.
I know, I'm sorry.
I apologize.
It's kind of like after all those years, they don't laugh at the jokes anymore.
Yeah.
Well, we have a tentative meeting schedule for the rest of the calendar year. And looking at this, I don't happen to have my own personal agenda book with me, or do I? This is Monday evenings, which most times we dedicate to the Board of Health. I like the fact, Sheila, that you have observed the holidays. Did you observe all of them?
Yes.
4th of July here, I see.
Sheila, can I ask you a question? was, or maybe to both of you, Sheila and Lisa, was there any impetus for coming up with it to schedule, throughout the whole year? I only mention that because there are times, for whatever reason, something might come up where we cancel a meeting, and it potentially could throw off the schedule for the rest of the year. So I didn't know if that was something that our town administrator was pushing for, something you're...
No, nobody pushed for it, but I did see that the selectmen have a calendar out for the year.
Okay.
And if we know when we're, nothing's set in stone, so as we go along, things come up and we have to cancel. We can, depending on the holidays, maybe you can just push it back a week or as opposed to 2 weeks or whatever.
And one of the reasons that was given at that point, why we were following the selectmen's summer schedule, correct me if I'm wrong, is the fact that if we're all meeting in the building on one specific Monday night, then the following Monday night we don't have to allot to the electricity and the time of the building being open.
And
which
this
is why.
And this follows the selectmen's...
It's close, yes.
Close.
Actually, they meet more often. I mean, they meet weekly.
Understand.
Yeah, they're going to do weekly.
Around holiday times.
Right. And what I found, thank you, Sheila, one of our meetings we canceled, but then we had a variance, and I believe we actually met the Monday that we weren't going to meet, and then we did, in fact, meet the following Monday. So I think that there may be times when we have to meet two Mondays in a row just to stay with the schedule.
Yeah. I just don't want the schedule, because it's going out through the whole calendar year 17. I don't want to be handcuffed by the schedule, but I think this, in the spirit that it was created, I have no objection.
Well, the idea was, too, is if you know you're going on vacation or something, you could say now.
Of course.
Right.
And if you know ahead of time, then we can make adjustments.
Okay, I want to go away on vacation on 4th of July.
I'll be in Chicago. That was
March, April, May. No, I'm kidding.
My godson's getting married.
Wonderful. So these really follow every 2 weeks.
That's fine.
If we have a need to change it, it doesn't have to be etched in stone.
So we're going to go by this rather than, I know at the end of each of our meetings you often will say, so we're going to meet,
I think I'm still going to do that as a reminder. I think it's important because we do have busy lives and we do tend to forget. So I think we'll still continue to remind. But it's going to follow, that's following every 2 weeks. And if we have a situation where somebody can't attend, I always have the privilege of being able to cancel the meeting. Depending
Good.
On vacation schedules and whatnot. And we know that Lisa has some vacation time in here.
Yes. As does Sheila, as do we all.
Right. So I think that we should start out following this. If it's subject to change, because unfortunately the Board of Health is not something that is regular things that happen, we'll leave it that it can be open for change. So I'm going to make a motion to accept currently at this time the presented Board of Health meeting agenda, knowing and recognizing that there can and will be instances that these dates do have to change.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Annual town meeting. Like to remind, the warrant opens on February 13th and closes on March 3rd. Lisa, do we as a board have anything that we are presenting?
No, we have only our budget. We did not have any articles.
Article 32.
I'm sorry?
We need to talk about...
yeah, that's coming.
The bylaw? Is that at
yes.
town meeting?
Yep. That is... I'm sorry. That yes. That's more... Forgive me for oversimplifying. It's more housekeeping. When the town voted that no one could take out permits if they owed the town any money, there were a few permits that you could take out that were excluded. One that was overlooked, for lack of a better term, was the livestock permits. And I'll explain why this is important. If we were to deny someone a livestock permit, say because they owed a water bill, and we didn't give them a permit to have their livestock, what would we do? I want everyone to seriously think about this. Do we go confiscate their chickens, their goats, their horses? We could do that, and should do that by law if they don't have a permit to have them. However, we have no place to house them.
Right.
We have no appropriate facilities or anything else. Therefore, in talking with both the town administrator, the treasurer collector, everyone agrees that this is one of those bylaws that needs to be excluded. We need to know where these animals are. We need people to register them for their safety, for public health and safety reasons. We need to know where they are. So we can't have people, you know, that, oh, a trash bill, not coming in and registering their animals. That's dangerous for them. That's dangerous for the town. And the town's not in a position to repossess or take possession of animals, which, again, you can do, but we would then be responsible for their health, their safety, their housing, which is a liability the town absolutely does not want to have.
When was the original, when was that original?
2015, but please don't hold me to it. It's not that old.
Okay.
Your point is valid, and I can't disagree at all. That being said, I do feel that the town needs to have whatever enforcement mechanisms.
Oh, we still do.
So,
we have liens. We have many other reasons. This was just an extra layer of enforcement the treasurer collector had added on. The town already has right to levy fines, to put liens on property for unpaid trash and water bills. The town has the right to do all those things already. The right to deny permits was more targeted at new permits. Say someone wanted a building permit or a permit to do something else, I don't know, improve their home, whatever. They wanted to be able to deny that until previous bills were taken.
So are we looking to make an official change?
It will be on town meeting floor. Yes, this is an official change that needs to be made. Mostly, again, because like I said, we need these animals registered for everyone's safety, and we are not equipped as a community to take any other action. In other words, if we deny a permit, we're not equipped to deal with enforcing that.
Can you, off the top of your head, to what degree are you seeing people looking for a livestock permit, and you may not even have any knowledge of this, where there is some money's owed?
We have no knowledge until the treasurer collector releases a list of those that owe. The overlap is there, but it's a nominal overlap. We're not talking about a significant number of persons that would be affected by this.
When we just went through our license renewal, you know, for all the people sending them out,
you get louder.
When we went through just the license renewals, you know, we sent out applications to people that had livestock already. I got a list from the treasurer's office of people, and there was nobody that was in arrears.
None.
None, but it's just in case. You know what I mean?
Okay.
We don't want to repossess someone's horse.
No.
That would be a very bad decision for us.
Although
or
maybe
be,
they
or
could
be forced to, because the bylaw is requiring us to do that.
To deny them a permit, correct.
Correct. Well,
we could set up an area holding it at the Bagni residence, perhaps.
We have a pound. It's right there in front of the town hall. That's for loose animals and seized animals. That's exactly
that small area. Really, so we better hope that we only have one or two chickens in there.
So is, this is going
across
between,
the street.
Is it going on town meeting floor?
Correct.
Okay.
And will you be presenting this to
more
the good
likely,
people of Pembroke?
More than likely, and explaining why it's important.
All right.
Okay. So there is nothing, you already are working on that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And
matter of fact, I will say right for the record, I believe that actually Ms. Chilcott has already written it, because it exactly mirrors the other two things that were already excluded.
And that's the only thing that's being added to that
Correct.
Article?
Correct.
That's already written, okay, or bylaw that's already been written, okay.
Correct.
Then we have the tentative dates, which I took out of order for the future meetings, and if I am not mistaken, we have hit everything on the agenda. Gary, do you have anything?
Yeah, I just have a question. I'm looking for my notes, Lisa.
Mm-hmm.
I know this came up at our last meeting, and I can't find it in my notes. When are you appearing before advisory on the budget?
We had postponed that because the intention was for the full board to look at the budget and like it. I mean, it is the budget from last year. It's been made very clear to me there are absolutely no additional funds, so we shouldn't go looking for them.
Well, so is there a date that you're appearing
for? No, I was waiting for the board's, all I was waiting for is the board's blessing that the same budget we've put forward for the last 5 years, only thing in there is the mandatory increases.
I've got it in my hand, so maybe I'm missing something. It looks like there's a requested increase of $600 on the overtime. Maybe I'm reading it wrong.
No, that's because town hall's open more. Like I said, the only things that are on there are mandatory.
So the overtime
is mandatory. A union personnel must be paid overtime for staying late on Monday nights as they do.
Okay, and that would be $600 over the course of a 12-month period?
I think the increase in hours is, yes.
Yeah. Okay, what about...
But, let me stop you right
ahead.
There, but let's say that we had to call an emergency meeting and needed Sheila to come in another night.
You would have to do a transfer.
We would have
additional funds.
It would be additional funds. So we try and keep the meetings to a minimum so we can stay within her overtime budget.
Okay, and you're increasing the performance appraisal, I see an increase of $60. Am I?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I'm.
Yes, and I'd have to ask Mike. I'm sure there's a job performance one.
So that's also a mandatory increase.
Correct.
And then on the vehicle maintenance, from
$1,000
to $1,500.
Yeah, just because the truck's older and we went over in previous years.
Okay, but. That
money is turned back if it's not used. Vehicle maintenance is strictly...
But you've requested that, the additional.
Actually, I did not, so I'm going to assume that someone put that in based on the fact that we went over last year. The truck is a 2007. I would imagine, and I have been advised, while it has new tires and it's been well adjusted and maintained, I would suspect it is not too long before we're going to see either of the front bearings go and or the brake lines on that truck.
Okay. As I mentioned at last, I would like to go, you know, as a former member of advisory for 3 years, I'd like to go.
Absolutely.
When you go, so just make sure that that's communicated.
I have not requested time because I was waiting for the board's approval of this before I went before them and presented.
Well, you haven't asked for any additional funds.
I don't, there's nothing to ask for.
Right.
And that's why I was just waiting for the board to say, well, yes, and we can ask for additional funds and we'll be told no because they're not there.
Yeah. So,
okay.
Are you okay with the budget?
I'm good with the budget. I just would like to have it done and...
All right, then I will make a set of and I'll let you know.
I'm also good with the budget.
Yeah. And I think I went last year as well. So if you could let us all know,
absolutely.
I'm sure Gail may very well like to attend.
Absolutely.
So if we are all there, it makes a very wonderful presentation.
Okay, are you done?
I think I'm done.
Okay, it's 7:55. I'd like to make a motion to adjourn our meeting of January 23rd, 2017 at 7:55.
I will second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, and our next meeting will be scheduled on February 6th. Good night.